So can we have the first question, please?
So my first question starts with a statement, actually. So the new white paper on energy sets a goal of zero carbon energy system. The International Energy Agency says that we will have to leave two-thirds of proven reserves of fossil fuels in the ground in order to contain climate change. So within that context, will you ban fracking? Will you end peat burning for electricity by 2020? And also, will you end coal burning in Money Point?
Okay.
Okay, thank you for the question, and thank you to Young Friends of the Earth and to the Environmental Pillar for inviting me to participate this evening. Just to answer the question specifically, yes, a balanced, secure energy mix is vital to our future growth and concerns across the worlds, and it can underpin our economic growth. In terms of fracking, Fianna Fáil is opposed to fracking. I've made that commitment a couple of years ago myself personally, but the party is committed to fracking, and if we are in government or in a position to influence the next role, we will ban fracking. We'll phase out peat burning facilities before 2030, and we'll end coal burning in Money Point by 2025 and convert it to biomass.
Okay, thank you.
Nice.
Okay, can we just let people speak, please?
Apologise for being late, and very glad to be here. I understood from 350.org, Bill McKibben doing the maths, we have to leave four-fifths of the known fossil fuels in the ground. And I would agree with the question in terms of all three. I think we have to, in my mind, the white paper says we will give up fossil fuels by 2100. It says that we could have up to 30% of fossil fuels in our energy mix by 2050. I don't see how that's possible within the agreement signed in Paris. The agreement signed in Paris, by my reading of it, is we will have to go fossil free by 2050 at the latest. And I would add a fourth commitment I think we should be seeking in any future government, which is I think we do not issue any new exploration licenses for fossil fuels offshore, or indeed onshore, that there isn't any onshore ones. Because I think if we're serious about this transition, we have to go for that 2050 date. And if we're serious, we have to play our part in leaving four-fifths of the fossils underground. It should be no fracking, no burning coal, no burning peat, but it should also, I would argue, be an end to any exploration for oil or gas in Irish waters or other territorial lands.
Okay, thank you. Richard Boyd Barrett. Apologies for the earlier
error. No problem. Yes, yes, and yes for all three. And
yes for four?
What's the fourth? There's three.
No more offshore exploration licences.
No, three questions. Yes.
Yes, to that as well. And it's in our manifesto, more to the point. And also, we won't be working as consultants for firms like Eamon is that are funded by Shell oil. So that's quite important as well. Is it IDG, Eamon?
It's IDG.
IDG isn't the consultancy firm you're working for?
No.
Okay. So you're going to ban fracking.
I've introduced a bill co-written by Friends of the Earth and Otashka into the door already before Christmas, calling for a ban on fracking. I also at the Environment Committee made a point of really highlighting what I think is just the disgraceful so-called review by the EIA of fracking, which I think is all of the work, the consultancy work, is actually done by people who were oil and gas companies.
This is the Environmental Protection Agency. Yeah, yeah.
AMEC and people, companies that are basically working for the oil and gas business who are doing the review. I think it's absolutely outrageous because it means it's not a balanced or objective review. It's been done by people who want fracking to start. As for the ending peat burning, as I've said, yes and yes to that. We need to move to biomass in Money Point. And of course, to achieve that in a sustainable way, so we don't have to import lots of the wood to burn in Money Point, we need a massive afforestation program, and that has to be resourced by the state. So a key thing for us is, if any of this is really going to happen, we have to take the oil and gas resources into public ownership, where we decide if at all any of them are used. And similarly, we should resist any attempt to privatise Cuilce, something that was supported by the government and by Eamon beside me. So we absolutely think natural resources of all sorts must be kept in public ownership if any of the pledges made on these issues are to be actually to be met.
Okay, thank you. Lynn Boylan.
Yep, just clear, I suppose we do support the phasing out of the peat burning and the coal burning at Money Point on the three peat burning stations by 2020, I think, for the peat burning, in 2025 for the coal. That is on, yep, for the coal burning. We're absolutely opposed to fracking, and we've been very consistent on this, both north and south on the island, and also in the European Parliament, which I think some of our parties seem to have a dual approach. They say one thing on the island and then they vote very differently in the European Union, and I suppose I've been to the fore in highlighting that only recently. And it was 2 weeks ago there was a call for a complete stopping to fracking, a ban on it, and Fine Gael supported the opposite. They refused to support a ban on fracking until studies are shown that this is safe, and we know it's not. Also, the EPA study, Sinn Fein, supported the Halt the Study campaign. And Richard Woodward is right, it was CDM Smith. They actually hosted the Shale conference in Poland in 2013. They didn't declare the conflict of interest when they tendered for carrying out that study. So they're absolutely, it's a flawed study. And while we agree that it should have been halted, we want to know if Fine Gael are back in government, are they going to just reopen that study? So we're opposed to fracking, without a doubt, as I said, both north and south and in the European Parliament. And what Sinn Féin is looking for is renewable, meeting our renewable targets, going above and beyond that. We have identified tidal as a wave production, wave energy, but also second generation biofuels. So using where the sugar beet had been grown to use for second generation, not first generation biofuels.
Okay, thank you. Pass the mic there.
Thank you very much. And Cáit Keane, Fine Gael, in government at the moment. And I'm actually proud of the fact, I think we'll be talking about the climate change bill that we brought through this year, and it's the very first year, I think we're 25 years waiting for a climate change bill. And this year, and I know, Eamon, when you were there, you did try your best at the time, but it didn't happen. But it may not be as strong as everybody wants it to be, but we will be discussing maybe the detail of it later and what it does. On the specific question, because the white paper does set a goal of zero carbon energy, of course you would be silly to say that we cannot go on using fossil fuel the way we are doing. COP21 in Paris, that was the same week that we put through our climate change bill, and we have set the targets there, and what we are going is on the European targets. I know personally probably you'd love to set the targets much lower, but we have to be realistic as well. And if I say no, 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 and no to everything, you do say that you actually have, Lynn mentioned the wave and tidal energy. That is at a research stage at the moment, and it is actually not in production commercially. So you have to be realistic as well in your proposals, that if you say no, 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 that you have to say yes, 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 realism, to what is going to be there, because when you...
Sorry, Coach, are you going to ban fracking and end people?
At the moment, there is a moratorium and fracking is banned until such time as the EPA. I want to contradict Richard and say not all of the people who are engaged in the surveys have conflicts of interest or anything like it. There's no way the EPA, you are absolutely doing a disservice to the EPA, who are...
Smith.
They're one of them, yes, like, yeah. But they have other experts as well, they're one. Now, when you are sitting on a committee, one voice doesn't always, it
okay.
may shout loudest,
so
but it may not be listened.
Before you ban
there is a moratorium onto the review. Personally,
but you voted
personally,
in Europe 2 weeks ago to not have a moratorium on fracking.
If there is at the moment, onto the EPA, I'm here in Ireland at the moment, and what I'm speaking on is what I'm doing here in Ireland at the moment, and that's what I've been asked about. And on fracking, until such time, I think personally, looking at fracking and knowing what I know about it, and have looking at the two films, the Shell film and the book, I personally wouldn't be in favour.
Okay.
But having said that, I have to be honest as well and say that is our policy onto the EPA reports.
So
now I will
burning.
Be peat burning as well. Obviously, and you know this government, what it has done for the bogs of Ireland and ensuring. And I know we have a member in Europe now who fought throw it in the flop as common against what we were doing with the bogs and saving the bogs. I do, yes, we have to move on to renewable energy, but sustainable renewable energy. We have the best land mass in Ireland for growing biomass, and in the DAX plant for biomass,
sorry,
that is
you're just
in,
running way over time
in London, I'm just saying burning. Sustainable biomass has to be the aim for this country, because
right.
It is
instead
a,
of peat burning.
Yes, we are to aim towards that, and that is our objective.
And
but we have to be realistic.
Money point?
What I'm saying is, you have to transition over a period. You can't ban it in the morning, because if we did, we'd close down everything. You know, you have to run the businesses, but we have to make sure. Wind is on renewable. I think there may be a question on renewable energy, and I hope there is, because if my time is up, there's lots of what we have to do, and there's lots of methodologies that we are supporting to
okay.
ensure that we have other methods to take place. So
okay.
definitely, yes.
Okay, Robert, thank you, Robert Dad from Labour Party.
In relation to fracking, page 52 of our manifesto commits us not to proceed with fracking. In relation to peat burning, we want to see that us to moving away from that as rapidly as possible. I think by 2020, but I haven't been able to check that particular date. In relation to money point, we wanted to close in terms of being a coal burning energy supply by 2025, and to replace it with an alternative that is much more.
Okay. Thank you.
In relation to the issue that Eamon Ryan brought up about no more exploration licenses for oil, we do not have a position on that, but I will bring back the idea because I think it is worth considering.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now, our second question is on the climate impacts of agriculture. Do you want to?
Yes. Ireland's agri sector accounts for 1/3 of greenhouse gas emissions, but only 4.7% of Irish jobs. How will you tackle the agri sector's disproportionate contribution to climate change? Do you support the proposed expansion of the national cattle herd? And if yes, how will you achieve the national policy of moving towards carbon neutrality in agriculture and land use?
Okay. Thank you. We'll go this way again, and we'll try to keep to our 2 minutes.
Okay. Thank you for the question. I suppose Fianna Fáil is committed to agriculture is my strong suit, being in Dublin Central. Okay, so I'm truly giving you the party line on this one. I apologise if it comes across as such, but that's what it is. So Fianna Fáil is committed to increasing funding to the beef genomic scheme. This scheme, I'm told, will be used to enhance technology, refine the feeding processes, and reduce emissions. I don't think anybody disputes the contribution, I certainly don't, and I don't think the party does in any way, that agriculture is making to our carbon footprint as a country. But I suppose being practical about it and being honest about it, agriculture is also a significant part of our way of life, of our country, of our culture, and of employment in the rural community. The CAP will be reviewed in 2017 to strengthen green measures such as carbon sinks, forestation and loss, and this will involve better use of farm technology to reduce emissions. The party does support extension of the national herd, and the 4.5% job figure is considered an underestimation, and that there's more likely 140,000 family farms supporting about almost 9% of the employment. So what I suppose we would try to achieve is a balanced recovery that will support the sustainable livelihoods in rural Ireland, but we do recognise the problem and it will have to be tackled, and try and develop alternative forms of employment over the long term.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
One thing that I very much agree in the white paper is that it says we need a national dialogue, a climate dialogue, and I think we need that this year. And I think we should use that as a template for a much wider debate about national development, spatial planning, we're going to put housing, and how we're going to manage our land. Because we need a dialogue around how we manage flooding, and we need plans for climate adaptation, as well as looking at mitigation. And I think that dialogue should be front and centre. I think in that...
Stick to agriculture.
Yes, because but that land issue should be dealt with in that national dialogue, and it should be looking at how we manage the land in every way, not just in relation to agriculture. You cannot separate out forestry, you cannot separate out protection of wilderness and biodiversity, it's all connected. And in instances we may be paying farmers for provision of biodiversity or provision of flood protection measures and not just food. And that's why I bring it in.
Okay.
Secondly, I think the current system and the plans to expand agricultural output in the industrial markets, commodity markets for milk powder, for meat and for other dairy products is not serving Irish farmers, because in the disconnect that exists between the farmers and their own markets, their power has been lost, the profits go to the processor and the large retailers, and it's actually not serving Irish farmers. And a lot of those family farms, Mary, to be honest, are old bachelors who are going to retire at some time in the next 10, 20 years. We need a new form of farming where young people can get access to the land, can get access to growing a whole variety of different crops, and not just crops for international markets, but ones for local markets where they get a better price, they get a better connection with the customers, and they have negotiating power rather than it belonging to other retailers.
So,
in that different form of agriculture, there's a better future for Irish farming than the one that Simon Cogan is driving down, which suits the large processors, but not the farmers in Ireland.
So, do you support the expansion of the...
No.
No. Okay, Richard?
No, I think the government are completely hostage to the big beef barons, essentially, and this is one of the major reasons that they are not willing to sign up to serious targets, and we're making special pleading at Paris to try and get out of any sort of agreement that would really deal with climate change. So I think we have to diversify agriculture in a big way, away from the sort of large-scale cattle export, live cattle export model. And we have to win the small farmers to understand that actually that would be beneficial to them. Again, forestry is very important in all this, in this regard, for multiple reasons. I don't need to explain to people that the environmental benefits at every level of forestry, but we need to make it worthwhile for farmers to move to forestry. And one of the big issues that's standing in the way at the moment is the replanting subsidies, that there isn't. There's planting subsidies, but not replanting subsidies, and we need to make it worthwhile for farmers to move into forestry, and also we need to encourage much more sort of localised food production aimed at local markets, so it's not all about transport for the export, the big export markets. Yeah.
Okay, all right, thank you. Sorry, we're working with one more.
I suppose just to start, I think one of the big problems we have with our policy in regards to agriculture and environment is that the two very rarely meet. And that's the same in the European Parliament, and it's the same at national level. And you need to have better collaboration between those two departments, because agriculture, we have to accept, it is a big part of the Irish economy. It does account for half of our exports, the agri-food business. So we have to face that reality. Also, we're going to be looking at a question around sustainable rural communities. Sustainable rural communities have to have farming as part of that. That's the natural process. You have to have people working in the rural communities. But we do need to look at the model of farming and the model of farming that's being pursued.
So do you support the proposed
expansion? We don't oppose it per se, but what Sinn Féin supports is a small family farm. We don't want to see further intensification of farming. And that's our policy position. And if you look at Michelle O'Neill in the North, who's the Minister for Agriculture, she has shortened the transition period to the flat rate payment, which benefits the smaller farmer rather than the large farmer. Also, just recently on the biodiversity midterm review in Europe, we put forward amendments looking particularly at the greening elements of the CAP. So the pillar two and what's called the ecological focus areas that farmers have to set up. We think that the criteria was too flexible in terms of what member states selected, but we also think that they should have tangible environmental benefits.
So what should agriculture do then?
So agriculture, we want the small family farms with promotion of agroecology, that form more organic farmings, definitely not GM. We were very disappointed that the Irish government didn't sign up for the GM cultivation opt-out by the deadline. So we're opposed to that. We want to see further development and implementation of the integrated pest management at farming level, and also then the reforestation. So the greening, so as carbon sinks, we want to see native trees planted, particularly along watercourses, that act as not only a carbon sink, but also stop the nutrient runoff into the watercourses.
Okay.
So it's about the type of farming that we have in Ireland.
Okay, thank you.
Definitely, it is about the type of farming and sustainable farming. And I think we are giving an insult to farmers when we say that agriculture and the environment don't meet, or farmers and the environment don't meet, because some of the farmers in Ireland are getting very environmentally conscious. And even if you looked at, what was it, EcoEye, or one of the programmes, Rural, which was on last night anyway, we had a young farmer there who had transformed his farm into totally organic farming, and pointed out that for his milk now, he's getting 62 cent a litre versus 32 for the non-organic farming. So the government is committed to ensuring that sustainable farming, and farmers are being educated. There's a great Chagas programme in ensuring that all young farmers are educated in a sustainable way. So I want to say the farmers are doing their bit. They can't do it all. They can't do everything.
So
I want to say the Foodwise 2025 programme that has been devised has a book of initiatives on supporting sustainable farming. Foodwise 2025, that does support, as I say. Again, I want to say
the
agriculture... Pardon? We have signed up to, and Minister Coveney, we are working in conjunction with. Now, we have to be realistic and recognise that expansion of the cow or the herd obviously will increase if nothing is done to decrease it. So you have to ensure, and the Minister for the Environment is in discussion at the moment, because the Minister for the Environment and the Minister for Agriculture has to work together to ensure you get best, if you like, value in CO2. And how do you do this? One of the ways, the carbon sinks was mentioned there by Eamon, and a massive increase in carbon sinks to ensure that happens as well in forestation. And there's a targeted, we may be criticised for not having targets in the climate action, but targets for ensuring forestation right throughout. The other thing as well, the sustainable agricultural industry is definitely given high priority with both the Minister for the Environment and the Minister for Agriculture. But as I said, you can't do it overnight. What the greening programme, establishing Ireland as a world leader in food, green food production, and that's the way we have to go. We have a green island. We've been known for St. Patrick's Day. We can be known for if we promote it further, and that is what the government is going to do to ensure that we promote Ireland as a green food island.
Okay.
So, just on the genetically modified food.
Well, that's actually
there is fantastic.
Question.
No, but I just want to say on treating a plant for organic growth and a 30% increase in plants. The University on Limerick and Austin Dara has radio wave technology there that gets rid of all pesticides, gets rid of all environmental pollutants, and treating plants. It's actually being used in other countries. That it should be used in this country as well. So when you radio treat an inner dry water and get rid of all this, you save your rivers, you save your lakes, you save everything else. So that is a new technology that is developed in Ireland, and definitely I can see great growth for it there in increasing food production and saving our environment at the same time.
Thank you.
Going back to what Eamon Ryan said earlier about the Energy White Paper and the need for a national conversation on this, I think that is absolutely important, because we must convince farmers that there is a way to make a living while at the same time adopting changes. An area of the country that I'm particularly familiar with, I won't actually name it in case anyone objects, but I know from talking to small farmers in that area that, you know, traditionally they do not see trees as a crop. Whereas if you go to a country like Finland, they see trees as a crop. So we do need to try to encourage a change of mentality in the whole farming area. I would be telling a lie if I said, well, we have opposed any increase in the beef herd. But what we have done, or sorry, the cattle herd, because I've listened to the beef at all, But we have committed ourselves to measures in the rural development plan 2014-20, such as, for example, the 350 million beef data and genomics scheme, which is directed at the emissions of 13,000 beef farmers. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our third question will look at the climate. Our third question will look at the climate targets.
The EPA projections state that Ireland will overshoot our annual EU targets by 2018 at the latest. Even more challenging targets for 2030 will be set by the EU this year. The new climate law underpins the national policy position of reducing emissions across electricity, buildings and transport by at least 80% by 2050. Two questions. Specifically, how do you intend to reach these targets? And what mitigation measures will you adopt in the next 5 years?
Okay, thank you. So can we try and keep to those two questions, please?
Okay. Thank you again for the question. And yeah, it is pretty pathetic that we're overshooting our targets and that we won't meet them. So we are fully committed to achieving our climate change targets, obviously as part of a broader European framework. Fianna Fáil, we have a series of proposals around tackling climate change. First one is, I suppose, to provide some political leadership around the issue by creating a new Department of Climate Change, and that department would be charged with leading the way in government to addressing climate change. It will amalgamate the departments of the Environment, Energy, Natural Resources, Heritage and Transport, and will have overarching responsibility for that objective. We'll set up a Green Deal agency within the Sustainable Energy Authority of Ireland to roll out retrofitting of both social and private homes. We will have a series of initiatives at €10 million dedicated to a series of initiatives to incentivise e-car usage. And this will include things like toll waiver for e-cars, motor tax waivers for e-cars, SEAI grants, and free charge points. We'll establish a National Infrastructure Commission with a series of targets, namely achieving 4% of GDP infrastructure investment per annum, decarbonising Ireland, and building a strong transport, public transport network. We will increase investment in public transport. I set an objective to freeze public transport fares. It's a big bugbear of mine here in Dublin City that over the last number of years, we've all seen the oil prices fall and energy prices fall, but fares on Dublin bus have increased significantly. There's been big investment into the fleet. The real-time information system has been very welcome. All of those enhancements, though, are really worth nothing. Wi-Fi on the buses and all of that, if the fares are continuing to rise, and they have increased 26%, and I have questions as for Dublin bus, but our commitments are, freeze fares, and really incentivise people to use public transportation.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sorry, just before Eamon, actually, you mentioned Wi-Fi. We forgot to say the guest Wi-Fi, if you want to tweet, it's hashtag GE16 environment, and you find a guest Wi-Fi in the list, and the password is wins1845. Apologies for not giving you that information at the beginning. Okay. Amen.
Just start by saying, as I said earlier, that if Paris is to mean anything, the targets that have provisionally been agreed for Ireland and for other countries are now to be ramped up significantly, and we have to get ready for that. We had negotiated with the Commission something like only a 4-5% increase in our ambition over the ones that we had put in the European climate legislation back in 2009. That's going to be significantly ramped up. We can do it. And it's going to be better for our country and our economy. And in the immediate 5 years, the key, going back to what we said earlier, is to switch off money point, to switch off the power plants, because that saves you 8 million tonnes of carbon, which is a significant chunk, and we can power our country, Cáit, absolutely properly at low cost with a combination of interconnection, renewable power and the existing gas-fired power stations. We do not need those power stations. And anyone who suggests they can be run on biomass, I think they need to present the evidence as to how that can be done and where the wood comes from. We'd have to cover the whole island and need about 10 more islands if you'd get the wood to actually power Bonnie Point the way some people have presented here today. We need to switch off 1 million oil-fired central heating systems. We need to drive efficiency in everything that we do and start in our buildings, because our buildings are badly designed. We need to adopt, to my mind, the Dutch scheme where you go in for deep retrofit, where you put on solar panels at the same time as you put on exterior insulation and you put on electric heating. The future, in my mind, is going to be electric, and we have this balancing system where a variable balancing renewable power supply is met with balancing demand for heat and water heating, in a transport and a whole lot of other areas. To make our transport system work, I believe we have to switch the transport budget at the moment from 2/3 road to 1/3 public transport, completely the other way, while we're waiting for the large-scale rail projects, which won't be doable in the next five years. That means a massive investment and political commitment to promoting cycling, walking, bus transport. And go back to my first key point in the earlier message, Sylvia. We need a national plan. We need a climate plan central to that plan. It needs to involve bringing people back to the centre of our villages, towns and cities.
Okay.
And that actually is one of the key developments. It's the planning of our country for this future. What we build now is going to be there in 50 years in a climate world. We start today with how we build and how we plan our houses where they go.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, first of all, we need to strengthen up the bill. The Act, should I say, the environmental pillar, we put in all their amendments when the bill was discussed. In the Dáil, which the government rejected pretty much all of them in terms of binding targets. We need binding national and sectoral targets, and we need the Dáil to be held, the government to be held accountable by the Dáil every single year to see are they actually meeting those targets at a sectoral and national level. We need to deliver on all of those targets. We need a whole range of things, and it has to, first of all, there has to be a sort of climate change strategy informing every single department of government right across the board. It shouldn't be just hived off to one group of people, but it should be seen as right across every department.
So
every,
what kind of mitigation measures?
Yeah. Insulation, right, a state-led and financed retrofit programme so that we don't just leave it to the market or we don't just leave it up to individuals if they can afford it, but the state provides the upfront funding and schemes that will make it happen. Obviously in local authority housing, government buildings, but also schemes to give people grants to do their own private homes. That would go a huge way towards helping meeting our targets. Again, afforestation is key. We're at 11%. The average EU average is 30. It's pathetic because we have the best conditions in Europe for growing trees. So again, this we need as well as giving incentives and subsidies to farmers. Cuilce has to engage in a massive afforestation program that may bring us up against Europe as well because of the whole state aid rules and so on, but we need to be able to stand up to Europe on that so that Cuilce can actually engage in planting. And I also submitted in the Forest Bill, which by the way, I think I was the only TD, I put about 40 amendments into the Forestry Bill to try and strengthen up and put binding targets in terms of afforestation, all of which were rejected by the government. But we need binding targets on afforestation rather than aspirations which are simply never delivered on. The other area is public transport is critical. We have to stop any move towards privatisation of public transport, because that would not lead to the expansion of public transport. It's already, as we speak, under this government and the last government, leading to public service routes being closed down, actually cut, not expanded, and that included under the last government, where routes that are not deemed profitable were being slashed. And this is a very trend. We have the lowest level of subsidy for public transport in most of Europe, and that has been consistently cut. So we need to reduce prices of public transport dramatically, and we need to increase the fleet in terms of public service in terms of public service routes. Very last point I want to make is Cáit Keane has 500,000 acres of land that is not deemed by Cáit Keane to be commercially viable for forestry, but it's just sitting there doing nothing. Right, that land should be given out to local communities to develop local community sustainable energy projects, small-scale forestation, small-scale hydro, and other small-scale localized district energy renewable energy projects.
Thank you.
Richard stole a lot of my lines on the transport.
Look,
I suppose in terms of emissions, it is about meeting our renewable targets, and I think certainly in terms of wind energy, I think it's mad that we're talking about selling wind energy when we're not meeting our targets on renewables as it is. So we need wind energy, but what we would believe in Sinn Féin is that wind energy should be community owned and not the big private developers. And by that way, the evidence shows that across Europe, where you have community owned or some dividend for the local communities, that wind is accepted by those communities. And that has happened in Denmark and in Germany. So we're very much in favour of wind energy, but that we do believe you need to have the community front and centre to it, and also the promotion of other renewable forms of energy. In terms of the mitigation measures, it has been said retrofitting is key. It needs to be rolled out in a greater scale. We also need the funding that's been taken away from local governments in terms of the window and door grant scheme that was decimated under the last two governments. That needs to be restored. You have houses, say in Fingal, that have 30-year-old doors and windows. The heat is just literally leaving the house. So you need to deal with that. You need to deal with the retrofitting. In Europe, we've called and currently working on a report around fuel poverty, looking at increasing the European funding for these sort of grant schemes rolled out across the member states. We also believe that the promotion of schemes such as Quality Build, where construction workers are trained up in how to build proper houses that are energy efficient. We do need, as Eamon has said, we need to look at the type of housing that we're building. Houses should be built with solar panels, they should be built with rain harvesting technology. All of that sort of stuff should be done in advance when you're rolling out housing building schemes and then retrofitting the current stock. Transport, look, it's a joke, the funding for transport. It is the least funded public transport system in the European Union. We need to roll out public transport across the country, not just in the urban centres, in rural communities. I think we have 2 million cars, or approximately 2 million cars in Ireland. Our emissions are through the roof. We've only got 0.04% of those are electric cars. We need to promote that, but also key to it is public transport and cycling lanes for people to get out of the transport altogether. And again, just looking at Europe and the sort of hypocrisy, only recently, again, our government party voted in favour of increasing the emissions for diesel cars by 100%. So, you have to act as you say you're going to act. We're talking about reducing emissions, and there we are in Europe, increasing diesel emissions. So public transport and retrofitting are key.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I think we will have a better chance now of ensuring that we reduce emissions in the fact that we have a bill, an act there now, and the fact as well that as part of that act, there's a climate change advisory council, an independent climate change advisory council, to advise the Minister on that. Also, as well as that the targets that are set, there's three strands to it, and I know, I think one of the panellists over there said, we need a national plan. In actual fact, we're going to, under the Climate Change Act now, we're going to have three national plans, the five-yearly mitigation plan, the five-yearly national adaptation framework, all of those charged within each department, they have to deal with transport, with energy, and it is measured and going to be measured, and it will come back to our report to the Dáil and Seanad to ensure that the targets that are set down under this national plan, obviously it has to be drawn up now. The bill has only been passed, as I said, the same week as, and I think it is historic that at COP21 in Paris, it was the very first time that we've had this. So we are moving. Some things are happening. Not enough, obviously, is happening at the moment, but our party definitely are serious about ensuring that the Climate Change Act is implemented and that we can strengthen it where. What you say, and climate justice, and myself, I had that written, and I must say, as well, Oisín Conlon from Friends of the Earth this year, and I worked with him on that to ensure that that was part of the bill or this act. It's in our draft or in our manifesto here on transport and electrification, and I won't have time to read it all, but Ireland has to become a leader in the take-up of electric vehicles. Within 6 months, the government, this is in our new manifesto, we will establish a dedicated task force to work on this goal, involving relevant government departments, agencies, industry and group representatives like yourself here. And I want to compliment you for calling this today, because another the Young Friends of the Earth and the group, the environmental group, the Ireland's transition to a low carbon energy 2015 to 2030. Now, when we talk about electric cars, it is becoming more realistic to ensure. You could talk pie in the sky maybe 5 years ago, but there's new batteries now, Tesla particularly, and Elon Musk, where storage for capacity, that is really coming on stream now. So it is becoming more realistic.
Okay, on wind,
I want people to stand up and be counted, because when we are talking, and I've been in the Midlands, and we have great proposals on wind, and if you have community groups standing up and say the benefits of wind, we have the best wind facilities here in this country, of all countries in Europe, but we have to ensure to involve the community. In our manifesto here, we will advance and involve community in energy development. We will advance this by implementing the White Paper on Energy and developing a framework how communities can share in the benefits of substantial new energy infrastructure in the areas and where they live. So if they get a slice of the cake of where the wind is blowing, that cake will be more attractive, not the way it is at the moment. Thank you. More of you.
In terms of specific plans in our manifesto, the first one is to establish a green infrastructure fund, half of which of about a billion, half of which would come from some of the sale of AIB shares that they have to be paid back to the government. We want to expand the whole retrofit of homes, and we're targeting 225,000 homes over the next 5 years. And I mean, one of the things that's worth saying in these things, because I think a great difficulty in terms of promoting a green economy is that people don't see often that it can actually be to the economic benefit of the country. But I mean, that such a move as that would create 13,000 jobs and save approximately 39 million in annual household energy bills. And I suppose, as there are a lot of green activists in this room, I think it's worth saying in general terms that the more you can say that there is an economic benefit with developing green energy and a green way of living, the better the chance you have of getting through to people who need to be persuaded on the issue. We also want to improve the public transport system by encouraging more people to cycle, and also to have a green bus fund to replace the state fleet with more cost-effective, less polluting buses. And we want a forum for, as we referred to earlier, we want to establish a forum for community energy engagement. And I think because it requires such a change of outlook on all our parts, I think that's a very important element in driving any change forward. And just one last thing. Planning is hugely important in terms of trying to improve transport. And I mean, we unfortunately have an abysmal record in Ireland. And part of it is because we all like to live in our own home, semi-detached or detached homes, and we need to learn a lot from maybe the Eastern Europeans. I mean, I'm struck, we have an STZ, a strategic development zone, in my constituency at Adamstown, but it's quite striking that the bulk of the population who live there are non-nationals, because they're used to living in slightly denser conditions. And I mean, Adamstown isn't a hugely dense development. If you go out and look at it, it's quite an attractive development. It still hasn't been finished. But I do think we do need to change our frame of mind, and that might also help in terms of bringing it back into the city. And it's a pity that the legal advice was that the tax on derelict sites can't be brought into effect until 2019, because more of those derelict sites in cities and towns that are filled with housing for people, the better.
Okay, thank you. Just to say that the objective is to hear everybody's policy this evening, so that's why everybody's getting a chance to speak uninterrupted. So, sorry, the next question is on nature protection.
Hi everybody, my name is Lynn Boylan, I'm with Bird Watch Ireland. So my question is, there's two parts to it, on protection for nature. But I just want to state, I don't know if you're aware, but biodiversity has been valued at conservatively being worth $2.6 billion to the Irish economy. This was a report done by the Department of the Environment a few years ago. But the state of our biodiversity, it's not in a good position. 91% of our internationally important habitats in Ireland are at bad or inadequate status. We're looking at severe declines of farmland bird species and breeding waders such as curlew. Curlew has declined by 80%. So that's just a small sample of what's happening with biodiversity in Ireland. And so, since the economic crash, we have seen a massive reduction in support for those working to protect our natural environment in the environmental NGO sector, as well as a 70% cut in funding for the National Parks and Wildlife Service, which was a disproportionate cut. They are charged with the protection of nature in Ireland. We've also recently seen an attempt to allow hedge cutting and upland burning a month earlier for both, at times when birds are nesting. More than 15,000 Irish people have recently signed a petition to stop this. This is a very detrimental act to be pursuing. So my questions are, will you oppose any extension of the cutting and burning season? And will you prioritise the restoration of funding to the National Parks and Wildlife Service to at least pre-crisis levels?
Thank you. We're actually going to start with you, Robert. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, we're
just going to switch the order for a change. Yeah, exactly. So just keep you all.
Put me in an embarrassing situation.
No, you'll be fine.
Of having to admit that there's nothing specific in our national manifesto in relation to the hedge cutting season and burning. I understand it was in our local election manifesto, and in many ways it is an issue for local authorities, but. I think you make a good point, and we are in favour of restoring funds to the National Parks and Wildlife Service.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
Thank you. Well, I'll take the easier question first, which is in the biodiversity plan, we have seven objectives there in the biodiversity plan. And I actually...
So are you going to oppose the extension to cutting and burning?
I just want to answer this part first. It's on the general... Pardon?
Could you answer that question?
I have taken up, as you know, the Heritage Bill and the Wildlife Action Section 40 was reviewed recently, and in the Heritage Act there was, and the Minister did, after consultation, and I did question this with her, with various groups and interests and non-interests as well, and it was extended, it is extended at the moment. It is it's not final, the bill isn't passed, so it's at a report stage at the moment. But the Minister has, I have been talking to the Minister about this because I want to ensure, number one, obviously we're bound by legislation and European legislation on biodiversity. When you say extended to the bird nesting season, there's no way that you could obviously burn a hedge or anything else if there's nests in it to ensure that that happens. Now the Minister has said to me, it's the drawing up of the guidelines is going to be important here and how those guidelines, because the guidelines haven't been drawn up as yet. So that's very important, and the Minister, they aren't done as yet, and that's where I have more questions to ask the Minister on that. Now, she has as well said that it is, and it is in the Act as well, that it is a pilot for 2 years, and a review of it after that. Now, as I said to the Minister, 2 years might be too late, because regeneration of a various species, if it goes for 1 year, it would be lost. So that is a question that I put to the Minister as well, and to ensure that the guidelines, when they are drawn up, if you have obviously places of nesting or whatever, that you have to have different guidelines for there that you would have for the side of the road where there's a hedge or whatever.
Okay.
But on the different objectives for biodiversity in general, we have seven, as I said, to strengthen the knowledge base for conservation, to increase...
We don't need all those. We move back from...
You want the bad news, but you don't want the good news.
Well,
but there's a little bit... There's a little bit...
Will you restore funding to the national parks and wildlife?
All organisations, as you know, and I will be speaking to community organisations tomorrow on a platform as well, every single organisation in the country, I think, was hit with cuts. And definitely now, with the fastest growing economy in Europe, when we took over, there was no money there. And I think everybody knows that, and people had to be cut. But now restoration is in progress. And definitely, all organisations now will see an improvement. I can't say that the full
30% to restore
yes, and in every aspect, but the detail of the percentage is not mentioned. And I think that's one of the things, will you restore it to pre-cut level? I can't give a commitment here that I'm going to win there next whenever, please God, if we're back, hopefully we'll be back in government. But I can give a commitment that all biodiversity, nature, and the programme, and the graph that's there on implementation will have to be done. And there's measurement there as well. And it isn't only me that's looking at it. There is a measurement process in train to ensure that the biodiversity programme, as outlined, with all the various bodies, is implemented.
Can
we can't do that.
Can we move to Lynn now?
The hands tied behind the back.
We're trying to keep to the questions.
Thanks. I think we'll take the funding first. You're right, funding was decimated to the National Parks and Wildlife Service. I believe it was halved in 2011, and then it's been chipped away progressively each year. We have committed to restoring it to pre-crisis levels, which I think is about 23 million. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but we have agreed to restore it. But also around nature protection and the biodiversity, when it came to the changes in the hedgerow cutting and the burning, we felt that the arguments that were put forward in favour of that were not robust enough to warrant a change in the practices. I'm an ecologist. It's one thing I do understand very clearly is biodiversity. And you're right, there are economic benefits to biodiversity that are not appreciated. For example, the pollinators, our agricultural industry depends absolutely on biodiversity. So to have anything that interferes with that, or to cut the funding that protects that biodiversity, it's going to have knock-on effects for other economic areas.
Okay.
So,
all right, thank you.
Yeah, we can give commitments on both of those questions. And more generally, we oppose any cuts that would adversely impact on biodiversity. But in addition, to return to my favourite subject of trees, we need a major public works programme because afforestation is really critical to enhancing native species in particular and shift away from the sort of monocultural model of forestry to enhance biodiversity. So,
that's
it.
Thank you.
Yes, we would commit to both the stopping the weakening of the environmental protection measures that has been introduced and also increasing or restoring funding for the Wildlife Service. Can I make one general point, just three very specifics?
Yeah.
First general point, and there was a very good conference organised by Green Foundation Ireland on the need for constitutional protection for nature. And I think that's one of the fundamental overarching changes we need to make so we have a legal mechanism of protecting nature. Three then specifics. First on forestation, I would agree with Richard, but I think we need to change to a form of continuous cover forestry rather than clear fairing forestry. That would have a significant benefit in terms of biodiversity. Secondly, as I understand talking to the best biologists and others, one of the biggest losses in our environmental quality is in the loss of pristine water quality. We need to make major investment in water systems to restore overall the level of high quality water. That's the big erosion that's taking place. And last but not least, in terms of our responsibility for our part of the planet, our sea area is 10 times our land area. The fisheries policy has been improved slightly, but not enough. We need significant areas where conservation is the first objective, and we restore the marine environment where the greatest destruction is taking place in our area of responsibility for the planet.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the question, and the answer is yes to both. In terms of the extending of the cutting and the burning, no, we will not support that. And in terms of the cuts and investment in, I suppose, social infrastructure, community services, or services, our manifesto is a very prudent manifesto. It's been independently costed, and it prioritises investment in public services over tax breaks. That's very different to what the government is promising, you know, the low US dollar taxes, which will mean further cuts or poor investment, at least, in social infrastructure. So,
okay. Thank you. Now we're going to move to, I think, what will be our last question on sustainable rural communities.
Thank you. Charles Stanislaw from Antashka and the Environment Pillar. So well, my question is about rural towns and sustainable communities, rural communities. And by the way, I come from a rural community. Rural towns across Ireland are dying. Poor planning for urban centres, poor planning generally, poor public transport links, one-off housing, the closing of essential services, and the lack of employment opportunities are contributing to this decline. How will you ensure that the life is kept in our communities across the country in a way that is socially, economically, and environmentally sustainable?
Robert, we'll start with you again.
I think one of the keys to making sustainable rural communities it relates to the whole provision of broadband, and the sooner broadband is rolled out right across the country, the easier it will be for some people to live in rural communities. And another thing that I would like to emphasise is that the more we can move away from one-off housing and try and cluster housing in towns and villages, the better. I think for some rural towns and villages to thrive, they will need to take action in their own hands. This is possible in some parts of the country, but not in others. For example, in relation to tourism, if a town or village has good potential tourist facilities in the neighbourhood, whether that be fishing in lakes or rivers or scenery or whatever, I think it's possible to improve the situation there. And I think it's also important, obviously, to support small farmers to keep their farms viable. But I mean, I think more that rural development can be around towns and villages, the more that will help to sustain those villages. But I mean, I think it's also worth saying that some towns are doing much better than others, and part of the reason for that is because of people's use of their cars. I mean, one area of the country that I know well is North Meath, and the town of Kells is economically on its knees compared to the town of Navan, and that's simply because people locally go to Navan rather than Kells to do their shopping. So, I mean, there are certain choices that people need to make in terms of their own immediate local environment. But it definitely would help the more. Things are clustered around towns or villages.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. And indeed, I think there should be good news for rural areas, particularly with the investment and the new broadband programme now that states that 85% and nearly everybody in the country will have broadband with the new programme that the government are rolling out. And I know the minister has stated that. And for it to come on stream, and because by having the broadband you can work, as you know, from anywhere, and it is attractive to live in the country health wise and everything else. Now the thing about creating jobs actually, when you say all of the jobs are going to Dublin and the urban area, that is not factually correct. In the last year, over 55% of the jobs that were created outside Dublin and the Mideast region. So jobs are being created, not obviously everywhere, but more jobs now are being created outside Dublin last year than inside Dublin. So that is a change, and that is a recognition that we do have to support rural communities. And they are are getting that with the job, the action plan for jobs. And again, there is a section, a full section there on how Fine Gael are supporting in with the action plan for jobs with that. I must say, in planning, particularly for the rural community, the rural community were let down indeed. But I know the Minister for the Environment, Minister Janice Sullivan, there in her short time in the planning department, she invoked section 31 of the Planning Act for what you would call bad planning with local authorities. She invoked it 10 times in her short 2 years, I think it was. And in the previous 10 years, it was only invoked, I think, 8 times. So that is a change, if you like, to say, well, you either you obey the laws that are drawn up nationally at local level, and I know you have to be strong and you have to do it, but that is the way it is. And the Minister has sent out a circular, the Minister for the Environment, to all local authorities now on that vein. And it is sustainable rural planning, again, and I know more on cluster development, like you have right around the continent, but not in Ireland. This one-off housing bungalow, this situation that we have, that destroyed rural communities, but it is changing. But obviously we have to be realistic as well in the way. The, as I say, there is a huge, I think, opportunity for rural communities, particularly if you go back to the food production, for local food production, to encourage that. And that is one of the initiatives as well that we are going to try and work on further for sustainable food production. And that feeds into job creation then in the country as well, because food miles is one of the hugest things for carbon in everywhere globally. And again, when we look at our health and air pollution, if you live in the country and people like the, you introduced the subject there, you have chosen to live in the country, but definitely for the EU clean air package as well, for the five main air pollutants, we will have to reduce it even further, the pollution, but in the country for that, with help, it's going to be a saving for the economy, because it has been costed to society from air pollution, as estimated for health-wise, 330 to 940 billion. But I'm just saying, living in the country, we can say everybody wants to live in Dublin. Why does everybody have to live in Dublin now? They don't have to. We're talking about transport. We need a rural transport links to facilitate that. We have initiatives in our manifesto as well on rural transport, to try with the leader program to develop rural transport links to make living in the country more attractive. Not everybody has to live in Dublin. With broadband coming, there will be more jobs and it will be more sustainable.
Thank you. Sorry, coach, it's not personal.
Not at all.
Sinn Fein has produced a document, a policy document called A New Deal for the West, which is to try and address sustainable rural communities, because rural communities have been decimated, particularly under the last number of years with the austerity, and you have GAA teams not even being able to field a team now because the villages have lost all of their young. So what our New Deal for the West is calling for, developing a new enterprise spatial strategy to orient infrastructure and development, but also to develop a regional cluster policy targeting specific sectors. So for example, a cluster sector of renewable energy. So to try and create the development on the West Coast, develop a green economy plan for the West. But we also need to look at the policies that have been implemented over the last number of years. The closing down of post offices, the closing down of Garda stations, the type of planning that we've had. So we have to review all of that.
But one of the other things that we're looking at is to provide financial stimulus for social enterprises and cooperatives, because they are rooted in their communities. They're not like foreign direct investment that can just up sticks and leave. We know, like the likes of microbreweries, I visited one in Monaghan recently, and they're employing locally. So we need to help this sector. I recently brought a delegation to Brussels to take part in what's called a social solidarity economy, because it is a huge employer across Europe. And in Ireland, we just don't get it. We don't get that social enterprise cooperative model and how important it is. And it's not just this government, it's previous governments. They seem to see it as a cottage industry. And it's not. It is a real employer, and we need to invest in it. We need to have ethical banking that finances these projects and give them the legal framework as well to protect it. And that's one way of creating employment in rural. We also, in this document, call for a pilot rural resettlement scheme, and where you would give a financial package to families to relocate.
Yeah, there has been there already, yeah.
And so we would be calling for that. And also we're looking at, in Europe, a derogation to the habitual residency to encourage people that would come into Ireland to move to the rural communities rather than to into urban communities.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, in broad terms, the depopulation of rural Ireland and the decline of towns, small towns, the economic decline of small towns is to a very large extent a product of the sort of corporate neoliberal for-profit economic model, which has inbuilt centrifugal.
But the world has become more urbanised, you know.
Yeah, and we need to go, we need to repopulate the rural areas, in my opinion. There's too much of a centrifugal tendency, and it's because of the nature of the market, that's what it does. It centralises things. So we need to go in the opposite way to the way the market is pushing us, and this is manifested at all sorts of levels. Stop closing small local hospitals. Stop closing, and indeed reopen, the small post offices. The state, again, has to provide the infrastructure in this regard. Oppose TTIP, very importantly. TTIP is going to destroy what's left of, if you like, small and medium enterprise, particularly in the rural areas. We also need a progressive rates policy. One of the things that's killing just small business generally is the growth of the big retail chains, driving small retail out of business. A progressive rates policy, which you have in countries like France and Scotland, would give lower rates for small business because it's based not just on square meterage, but it's based on turnover, right, and profitability. So your bank or your Aldi or your Lidl or your Tesco would pay far higher rates than your butcher, your baker, your candlestick maker. That is the policy that is pursued in places like France. That's why village life, if you like, is still...
Well, I think it's declining.
It's under pressure, but there's a more directed, focused effort to try and retain it. And in Scotland, actually, they brought in the progressive rate system, and 60% of small and medium enterprise benefited, but it meant the big guys paid more. So I think that would be another important part of revitalising small towns and rural areas.
Thank you.
Charles, to answer your question, could I suggest you talk to Garrett Fitzgibbon, our candidate in Tipperary, who has done as a community worker an amazing job with the community of Drumban in bringing people back to the Hurley team by driving energy efficiency as one of the community projects that's turned that whole community around. Can I suggest you go and talk to Fergal Smith, our candidate in Clare, who's actually digging and developing a community support agriculture scheme that is a real project and is fighting there to keep an Aldi out of his local Ennis Diamond town and has a real clear idea of what that future of food could be. Can I suggest you talk to Grace O'Sullivan, our candidate in Waterford, who's done more than anyone else to show how tourism connecting to nature can work, not just for overseas visitors, but for our own people to get appreciation of nature. Can I suggest you talk to Seamus McMenamin, our candidate in Westmead, who's working as a community doctor and has a better idea than anyone else how we could develop a community local health system? Can I suggest you listen to Michael McGann? Can I suggest you listen to Michael McGann on the vision for how the Midlands of this country could be the centre of a new green renaissance where we actually create jobs and create vibrancy? We have them all over the country. Every single one of our candidates is doing in real life what you're seeking to achieve in your question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Sylvia, and thank you for the question as well. I suppose I would have to say that we're a party that has absolutely no TDs in Dublin, so I think we have the rural community well in our sights. So all of the 19 Fianna Fáil TDs would probably give a much better response to your question than I'll do, but let me just tell you that we have in our manifesto a very comprehensive policy proposals from all of the TDs around the areas that will and issues that will make our rural communities not just survive but thrive.
Just
and
name
grow.
One or two, Mary.
Yeah, I'm going to. Yeah. I think to be fair, I was meant to leave at 6:30, and I stayed deliberately because I want
to. We'll
okay.
On this.
So, in terms of making it possible for people to live in rural communities, we have a proposal around shared sites, so where people would be able to actually live in the local area, but they'd be shared sites, and people could access services and build houses in clusters, as opposed to the individual one-off houses. We also have proposals around reforming the whole commercial rates in town centres, supporting employment in the rural community, not just in terms of supporting our farmers in the agricultural community, in transitioning to environmentally friendly agricultural practices, but also the local employment offices and supporting small enterprise and small businesses and employers in our rural communities. Specifically, I suppose, around that, you know, the state has a role to play in terms of post offices, in terms of the guard stations, in terms of small schools, and we've got very specific proposals around sustaining all of them. The post offices, it's not just about the infrastructure of post offices, it's actually about the state providing the post offices with business to sustain the post offices, and that's about the government's payments plan, and we are very strong on that, and we have supported the retention and the saving of all of the local post offices and the saving of small schools. For businesses, I work in the technology sector, and I know very well how you can run a business, a European and international, a global business, from any corner in Ireland if you do have access to the technology and to the broadband infrastructure. So we're absolutely committed to that. In terms of public transportation, that's essential as well, and we're committed to that. And I just want to check that I didn't miss anything else out that they wanted me. And yeah, finally, and this is, I think, very important, town councils were abolished. Now, it wasn't the only travesty in the supposed putting people first document and policy, but it was a big one in terms of a removal of local democracy. I'm not in favour of more politicians, but I am in favour, and we as a party are committed to empowering communities to have more say in how their communities are run. And so we will restore local town councils, and we will create new community councils to ensure that rural communities and local communities do have a strong say in how their communities are run. Can I just now apologise to everybody?
It's
because
just
I
finished.
Okay, but I'm going to leave, and they're going to think that I'm leaving.
No,
leaving.
No.
I am.
Finish it.
Okay,
just
so
finish.
Thank you.
We're
finishing,
Mary.
With a question now. Listen, first of all, I'd really, really like to thank the 6 speakers for taking the time out, and particularly the 3 canvassing candidates, because there's a big sacrifice for them to come here. But I think you have to admit that every one of them has given an honest, straightforward answer to the questions that were given to them. You may not agree with them, but you got good answers from them. So I'd like you to give them a round of applause, please.